Thinking about self-publishing and don't know where to start? Join the Spa Girls each week for 30 or 40 minutes of honest advice, tips, and resources. I'm Trudy Jay, and
I'm Shah Barrett.
And I'm Cheryl.
And I messed up the intro. Welcome to another week with the Spa Girls. We're without Wendy this week, but instead of Wendy, we have the delightful Jay Hogan here. Woo-hoo! With us.
Yay. Welcome, Jay.
Hi. Now, Jay is another New Zealand author who is doing awesomely well in MM romance, male-male romance. So we're going to talk all about that and a whole bunch of other topics with you soon. But first, I'm going to do your bio. So, and then we'll get right into the questioning. I mean, questions.
Interrogation.
Yeah.
Jay is a 2020 Lambda Literary Award finalist in gay romance, and her book Off Balance was the 2021 New Zealand Romance Book of the Year. She is a New Zealand author writing MM romance and romantic suspense, primarily set in New Zealand. She writes character-driven romances with lots of humour, a good dose of reality, and a splash of angst. She's travelled extensively, lived in many countries, and in a past life, she was a critical care nurse, nurse educator, and counsellor. Jay is owned by a huge Maine Coon cat and a gorgeous Cocker Spaniel. I love Maine Coons. I'm just kind of like,
I had two. Yeah, love them. Yeah. But that's not what we're here to talk about.
Yes.
We can.
I could talk cats all day long, but I get shouted down when I do that, Jay. So
yeah,
I put a lot of them in my books.
So let's sort of talk about how you got into writing and publishing, because you did it a bit later in life. It wasn't something that you've done sort of, or was it something you've done your whole entire life and just published later on? Tell us all.
Expose.
Yeah.
I always did write. I always liked writing. And I guess I probably wanted to be a writer as a teenager. But, you know, in the 70s, that wasn't going to be something that was really a career path. And that was well before the digital age. So, you know, I did write a couple of books in my early 30s. Nothing to do with romance. I don't think I'd picked up a romance book till I was 50. So the early ones were kind of what I read a lot, which were police procedurals and that kind of thing, thrillers, serial killers, all of that. So I actually wrote a couple of books like that. But they didn't really go anywhere, and I wasn't particularly happy with them. I had them edited and stuff, and the writing was always said to be good, but the storylines I just couldn't kind of find a home. It wasn't kind of right for me, and so they composted in a drawer. Those days, I did send them off to a couple of places, but that was the era where you sent it off snail mail. You waited maybe a year to get it back from a publisher to say no. And most publishers wouldn't allow you to put it out with any other publisher before they had already said no to it. So it was a very slow process. You get it back, you turn it around, you send it out again. So I did have poetry published when I was in my 20s. So I had always mucked around with writing. But then kind of life took over after that, and I could keep writing, but just for interest, didn't actually write a full book or anything like that. And then, you know, I've just raised a kid and worked that's right. And then I actually think it's good that for me that it didn't happen, my writing didn't sort of take off till later on when my daughter had left home, because I didn't have to worry about feeling guilty about all the time that it takes. I could actually, once it happened and I realised what I wanted to do and the genre I wanted to write in, I could give it all the time that it needed. So I actually, in some ways, I'm quite grateful for that. Because I get overwhelmed enough if I don't take the dog for a walk every day. So, you know, to have pulled myself away from a teenager would have been really difficult.
Yeah.
So
then I read my first MM romance book at about maybe 2016.
Okay.
And it was like I read the book and I thought, holy shit, I think I could write this. I was so excited by just by the whole concept, and I think we've just been talking about the fact that all the roles are up in the air, you know, the stories are much grittier. There's a whole range of things that you can write. And I'm a bisexual myself, so I had that tie-in to the whole LGBT thing. Mm-hmm. Knew what it was like to be 70 in the 70s and 80s, knew what it was like to have not told anyone, kind of be closeted and things. Mm-hmm. So it was just like the genre found me. It was, mm-hmm. you know, timing is everything in life,
yeah.
isn't it?
Yes. That
genre wasn't mm-hmm. really readily available
yep.
back mm-hmm. when I was younger. So, you know, I grew up. Romance grew up, and all of a sudden there was a meeting point, and I read that book, which was Abigail Rue's Cut and Run series, and I was kind of hooked, and I spent a whole year reading virtually nothing else but, and the next year I started to write my first impressions book, which was my debut book.
How awesome. I love that. Serendipity.
Yes.
Yeah. Love that.
So did you spend that time reading all the other MM books, knowing that you were sort of doing it for research, or just because you enjoyed them, or both?
Yeah. I mean, I really enjoyed them, but considering I've never even read romance other than Nora Rodd, J.D. Robb, that, you know, that style, I was one of these people who kind of, I guess, was a bit snobby about romance, really. And, you know, I slap myself now. How stupid was that? But, I needed to do the research, and you need to learn in romance about how the whole tropes work, how the beats work in a story. There's quite a lot to learn. So it's like going to university. You know, spend a year and you just study something.
Mm-hmm.
And I loved the story, so it wasn't exactly hard.
Yeah,
that's awesome. So could you, are there sort of tropes that are specific to MM romance, or, you know, is there anything that you think that you have to have in a MM romance that maybe other, if you're right, someone writing other genres that you wouldn't have, or is it just like a normal, or not a normal, sorry, just another like a rom-com or a standard, yeah. you know, are there different tropes that are specific to MM, or is it just the same?
Well, there's a lot that are similar. It's just that sort of you get takes of a trope, you know, so it's just an MM take on a trope. There are some that would be fairly distinct. Like when you talk about people being closeted, maybe when you're talking about, you know, because their tropes involve drag queens and more femme characters. And so there are some specific characteristics, but whether that you'd call it an actual trope or just kind of a take on that trope. Most of the time, the dominant tropes or the familiar ones in male-female romance are going to be repeated, you know, whether it's
enemies to lovers
and town, all of that, so you're still hitting those same emotional points, you're just doing it with a different take, and there'll be a few specific characteristics that are to do with LGBT and being closeted and stuff, but a lot of it is just a version of the of very similar tropes that most romance readers would recognise.
How important is it, do you think, to have, so you mentioned sort of you're bisexual and you've got that link to the community, and I remember you did a talk last year at RWNZ at the conference, and you talked about kind of knowing the right kind of terminology and kind of knowing a bit about the world of I don't know, male-male romance. Do you think that's really important, or do you think someone can just come in and give it a bash? Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, you can come in and give it a bash.
You think they're
likely to have it returned to you. I think if you want to be successful at it and you want it to be taken seriously, then you need to know your stuff. The readers who read romance are voracious readers anyway, and MM romance almost more so in some ways. You know, I have readers who are reading, you know, 300 to 500 books a year, so they're reading a whole lot of stuff. They know, they're well familiar with what the issues are for the community. Doesn't mean to say they're always respectful of it, you know, or that all books are respectful of the community, but it's getting a lot better, and we're weeding out tropes and language and things which are unhelpful
such as, you know, Gay for You trope, which is really is bisexual awakening, you know. So that terminology, Gay for You, is quite offensive to a lot of people within the community. It's not necessarily meant that way, but it kind of doesn't recognise, you know, that fluidity, I guess, of particular bisexuality within people. And so people, it's not necessarily that you're gay, you come out gay for someone, is that you're discovering a latent part of yourself that you didn't necessarily understand. So yeah, so you do need to know, and you'll get called on it, you know. It's quite interesting sometimes. I look through people who have written predominantly heterosexual heterosexual romance, there you go. And you get some readership who will look at perhaps a new book that person's put out. So they've decided to move and broaden their base, and they put out an romance. And some of if there's criticism there, some of it's around the language and around things which are kind of cliched or old. And so you need to be up to date with it. And even I don't always need, if I'm writing a character that I'm a little unfamiliar with, non-binary, often that there was a big learning curve for me. I do a lot of research into that to try and get it right, so that anyone who's reading that book and who fits into those categories or whatever is going to read it and see a reasonable representation of who they are.
Yeah.
You know, you've got a community and a group of readers who have been disenfranchised and marginalised, or you're writing about a group who have been disenfranchised and marginalised, and that means you need to, you know, put the respect in place.
Mm, yeah, that's awesome. So if we move on to, like, the as the genre, so we talked about how it wasn't actually a genre even that you could have written in, you know, when you first started writing. So what's it like now? Is it have these voracious readers? Is it still a growing and expanding genre? Can you sort of talk along those lines for?
Yeah, it's probably the fastest growing subgenre of romance, and it as a genre, it incorporates all the things like, you know, science fiction and fantasy, yeah, and right, you know, all of those. So you've got subgenres within the genre as well. And it's very competitive. I think that's what some people don't always realise, that there's a lot of authors out there. The readership is voracious, but the competition for readership is very strong. So that's one of the other things, that if you're going to write it, you want to write a good book and you want to get things right in it, because it isn't easy like it was in the early days before my time, when a lot of authors were making a lot of money reasonably quickly, when there weren't a lot of authors out there writing. Now there are. There's a lot of good authors, and so the competition is harder, and it's good for the genre, because it does make sure that, you know, the emphasis is on good editing, getting your things proofread, you know, nothing slips by anymore. And I think that can be nothing but good, good things for it. And it is growing partly because it's being kind of a marginalized or slightly on the fringes genre of romance. It came into readership popularity through things like KU, which is, you know, a dodgy kind of subject to get into, because it's got its good and its bad points about it. But a bit like what's happening now with LGBT documentaries and dramas and films through Netflix, you know, you're getting a broader exposure to people who are taking a risk on looking at things like Schitt's Creek, you know, looking at stuff they might never have chosen before, partly because, you know, they can do it in the privacy of their own home, on the privacy of their Kindle, no one knows what you're reading. And so those subscription services, for all of the issues that they have, were actually quite important initially in the growth of MM, because readers took a chance, you know, and then they found, oh yeah, actually I like this. And so you have more and more. And that's what's one of the big difference in terms of marketing and sales between MM and MF books is that MM readership are diehard KU. You know, you've got to consider that when you're putting stuff out there. And MF is, you know, much often wider. You know, they go wide rather than into KU. And it's a definite difference between the two.
Yeah, okay, that makes sense. I had a question. Oh my gosh. So definitely KU if you're starting out as MM romance writer, you think? Like you wouldn't?
Well, no, I think that's a choice you have to make. There are MM authors who, you know, don't like publishing with Amazon, certainly don't like KU and go wide, and that's their choice. It's a longer, harder road, but they like doing it and, you know, good on them. There's also people probably more commonly now who will cycle series and books in and out of KU. Mm-hmm. So they'll have some wide and then they'll have some in KU. I'm just beginning to do that now. I've kind of got enough books to do that. But I looked on it as almost like a marketing tool. So when you're a new author, I found it, for me, this is just my opinion, it was very useful to get my books out there, have people be able to, if they've got the subscription, read them, make a decision, maybe read the next one. And so you build your readership from that. And then now I'm just slowly sort of moving into the stage where I'll be pulling them in and out and working with them a little bit more more flexibility.
Okay, well, that's cool.
So how do you plan on doing that? Would you take the older series wider? Like, have you got any thoughts around how you would actually go about doing that, Jay?
Okay, so I've just about to put Digging Deep out wide, which is a standalone book. Right. So that's going out in March. Mm-hmm. And the other book that's going out very quickly is First Impressions, the lead into the series. I won't be putting the rest of the series out yet, but I'll be putting First Impressions out. Mm-hmm. And so that, to see how that goes. Yeah. And then the lead into the rest of the series is on Amazon. And then possibly towards the end of this year, I might look at putting the rest of the series, doing a bundle and then putting that out as well. So it's just a bit playing with the water at the moment and just, mm-hmm. you know, you make a move and you kind of see how that looks on the sales mm-hmm. and everything. And then you follow through. And I think it's a good idea if you're coming out of KU to do it slowly initially, mm-hmm. Rather, because if you know, there's a lot if you're a dominantly KU author, like all my stuff was in KU, then you've got a fair percentage of your income coming mm-hmm. from that.
Yeah.
And slowly the book sales are actually growing for me. I found the last year I'm selling more books or people are reading in KU and then they'll buy the book.
Yes.
But if you take everything out in one go, it's... Mm.
Yeah.
It's kind of like, if you want to pay your bills, it's probably my good choice.
Yeah. For the more impulsive amongst us, it's sort of, maybe slow it down there a little bit. It's good advice.
I think you can use it for you. That's the difference. KU can do you over, particularly if you're an author with shorter books. I have an advantage. I have longer books. Mm-hmm. So by the time they read one book for mine in KU, they'll almost read two books. And how that's my advantage.
How long are your books? Are they...
I tend to have a sweet spot between 100 and 120,000.
Oh, wow. Words. They are long. Okay.
My shortest book, I think, is just under 90, 85.
Mm. Okay.
So that's good for page reads, isn't it? So
that's unlimited
that we're talking about. That's a subscription service, and so you can get paid by the page reads.
Yeah.
Mm. So is that your natural kind of right word count, Jay, that you've kind of, that's your happy place, or is it something you've consciously done to write longer, more of?
I struggle to keep it down there, actually.
Okay.
Digging Deep is actually 126,000 words. That was the second book I wrote. First Impressions I got down to, that's about 94,000, 95,000. But when I first put that in, when it was accepted, it was nearly 130,000 words. So it was a very sharp learning curve. I edited over 30,000 words out of it in that first edit, and it taught me to be ruthless. It's been a very good lesson that I've learned.
Yeah.
But I do struggle to keep it down. But I think most authors who write character-driven stuff probably struggle with that.
Mm-hmm. And how long does it take you to write a book? Is that of that length?
In my first draft, generally about 2 months.
Mm-hmm.
And then I can get a second draft done in a couple of weeks, and then it goes. My first draft is a bit of a misnomer, really, because I constantly write and then go back and rewrite, and so I'm layering all the time.
Okay.
So by the time I get to the end, I probably almost had 3 drafts yes. on it by the end of my first draft. And then the second draft, the book's done by then. I don't leave anything unsaid. I don't leave right sex scene here or anything like that. It's done from start to finish. So the second draft is upgrading words, descriptions, it's grammar, it's, you know, all of that, making it look pretty, you know, rather than just the straight wording of the first draft.
And are you a plotter or a pantser?
My natural habitat is a pantser, but if I let that run free range, I'll have 130,000 books all the time. So what I do now is I have a couple of pages that are a rough outline of where the character's going. I kind of know where they're going emotionally, and I don't always know where they're going, how they're going to get there. So I'll do that, and I'll have a rough idea in my head that will be miles away from how it actually finishes in terms of the plot. But I'll probably write the first maybe 25,000 words, sticking pretty much to where I thought it was going. And that happens quite quickly. I'll do that within a week or so.
Mm.
And then it starts, the characters are fully in my head and really kind of having a conversation, I'll then start to think, no, they wouldn't do that. So actually that doesn't feel natural. So I'll go back and I'll change it, or I'll change the direction, and that's when I start to do a plot that's just 1 or 2 chapters ahead.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'll know where this chapter's going, and I have an idea where the next one's going, and I'll get to the end of that one and I'll think, yep, we're still going to go that way. I'll think, no, this. And that's kind of why I don't also leave like a sex scene not written, because for me things happen in that will dictate what happens in the next chapter. It's not just a sex scene, it's never just a sex scene. If it is, I don't put it in there. There always has to be something, not if it's a full one, which for me, if you're going to have pages written about something, then there needs to be a character shift that happens within that, or some kind of understanding.
Which is advice for any kind of sex scene in any book you write, right? Like that's it shouldn't just be there for the sake of it.
How many point of views are you using? Is it first person, or are you
I use first person past, and I 2 points of view. I've never written a 1 point of view book. I'm thinking about doing a series next year, but I actually really enjoy being in both heads. And for character driven stuff, I like bringing those two disparate characters together, and that's really only something you can do if you're in both heads. I read a lot of one head books, surprisingly, but I find I always know one person better than the other. And I just like writing in if it's a relationship, I just like writing, two.
Gives you that reaction, doesn't it? Dealing with what's happening. I really wanted to know about editing. You say that you have an editor. How, I won't say difficult, but how important was it to get the right person for your books?
I think that's almost the most important thing you do. Apart from your own writing, the next most important thing you do is you get a good editor. And my editor for the first publishing place who took my first book did an okay job. When I was with that moved to another publishing company, they were better, but no one really picked up. So I had to then go years later when I got all my rights back. I redid again, re-edited and redid those first couple of books and changed them significantly with kind of what I'd learned that I felt at the time should have been picked up then. I went on the hunt when I got my rights back. I had to make a decision within sort of 3 or 4 weeks, and I was lucky enough to pick up an editor who also edits for E.N.R. Walker, who's a big MM writer in Australia. So she was used to, she's American herself, the editor, but she was used to kind of a bit of the language down here and point and how we think. Mm-hmm. And yeah, Posey does all my editing now. She does my developmental edit and then she does a copy edit, and she's brutal in developmental edit. I mean, I've got stuff back from her that I've been in tears about, thinking, oh my God, this is 2 weeks work to get this fixed. But every single, I mean, there's been others which have been, you know, she sent back and said, yes, you've hit the, it's fine.
Yeah.
But the more complicated the emotionally the book is, usually the more developmental editing needs to be done to get it right, you know. And she, you know, she does a really good job, and my books are 100% better for going through that process.
So does she do both? She does the developmental look and then you send it back and she does the line or copy.
That's really interesting, isn't it?
Yeah.
I don't always have that, do usually have two
yeah.
different people. But.
And I use no beta editors or beta readers or alpha readers.
Okay.
Because of how I write, I can't have any interference in the process because I go back like this. So I can't send someone a chapter because that chapter's not likely to stay the same, you know, 3 weeks later.
Yeah.
And if I get anything, you know, dreadfully sensitive, if I get anything negative back, it can paralyze me for a week, you know, to get the confidence to get back up. So I trust my, I've learned, I have to trust myself to get that first draft done. And then the only beta reader I have reads after the developmental edit is done. And basically all she does is confirm that I've kind of picked up anything, any points. And also she's really good at pulling out teaser lines and funny bits and stuff for my promo down the track. She's really good at that. Yeah. So then I don't have to do that or remember that. She actually highlights it all the way through. And she might pick up a couple of things about, you know, something that might need to be changing or something that's out of place. So she gets that. And then it goes to someone who does my continuity edit. It was actually just a reader. Who is a very detailed reading person who actually gave me a couple of pointers of books I'd published and said, you know, wrote me nice messages and said, you know, did you realise that da-da-da-da-da-da-da. And like, she's really good at picking up the fact that he was wearing his jeans a page before and he's not now, you know. And nobody else had picked that up through proofreading or anything. So she's very good. So she gets it for a week. And she also listens to it, and then I make sure all my continuity stuff's done, and then it goes to another 2 paid proofers after that, and then it goes to 2 early ARC readers who pick up any final problems.
Oh, wow, so that's really getting a detailed look, isn't it?
Yeah, I hate sending things out. It'll still have mistakes. It will always still have, you know, something which is silly that's just gone through, but... Yeah, I really don't like putting it out if it's not.
So you mentioned that you had a couple with publishers. Was that when you first started off, Jay? With
I actually it was Blushing Books. Do you know them?
Yes.
So they had a they were looking at doing MM, and then so I got in. They accepted the first book. And then they decided they didn't want to go that way, which was quite good because I got my rights back after a year. And then they were, in the meantime, Dream Spinner had picked up Crossing the Touchline, I think, or Digging Deep, might have been Digging Deep. And so they picked up the other ones that Blushing Books let go. And then Dream Spinner had financial problems and I took the opportunity to take all my rights back at that point and decided I would self-publish.
And when was that? What year? That was in...
That was the end of 2019.
Okay.
Not that long ago, really, is it?
No.
No, really not.
Although anything before 2020 feels like it's years ago.
Yeah. Another decade perhaps, I suppose.
Yeah.
But in publishing years, that's really fast. Like that's not that long ago at all. So
that's awesome.
Yeah.
So another thing I wanted to bring up was the fact that you actually have an American editor, is that right? So you're not writing in New Zealand speak.
Well, I mean, all my books are Kiwi.
Yeah.
So she's very good in that she will do things like, you know, what the hell is this? Yeah. Which would be something like, I can't remember the last time, last thing I was talking about. I think it was a bacon butty or something like that.
Yeah. You know?
So she'll pick up, won't necessarily change it, but she loves sort of accruing to write that in a little notebook and stuff. So she doesn't change any of my Kiwi style. She's not, I mean, I wouldn't do that anyway. Mm-hmm. But she's quite good at alerting me to what Americans might really struggle with.
Mm-hmm.
And although I don't change stuff for that, there's a couple of times I will. One is that if the word or whatever will take the reader out of an action scene or out of a sex scene because it's just so foreign to them, or the phrase, that it'll interrupt the reading. Mm-hmm. And then I'll look for a more neutral kind of word to replace it. But other than that, it kind of stays as it is. So she's just kind of alerting me, really.
So can I ask you a few questions around that? So is your main audience American readers? Are you aiming for American readers? And are you using American or New Zealand spelling? Can you explain what a bacon butty is?
We know, but we
have a few listeners who probably don't.
Yeah. So a bacon butty is actually probably in English. It is an English terminology. Yes, it's just where you have soft bread, untoasted and usually slathered with butter, and you put bacon in the middle, and you do the same like a chip butty as well, you know.
Yeah.
And you squish it together. It's really important. The squish factor is really important.
And you've got to have some tomato sauce on there too.
You may or may not
have tomato sauce. Yeah, bacon and egg butty, I mean, you can take it right out there wherever you want to go.
Yeah.
So what were you talking about? Oh, who's spelling?
Spelling.
I'm really Kiwi, very Kiwi. So for me to write or in American style is difficult for me. I've done it, you know. I did the character in Unguarded. I had one character was Kiwi and one character lived in Vermont, and my editor was very important for that because she would then spent a lot of time. It takes her longer because she has to correct all my my Kiwi-isms for the American character, you know, sidewalk and pavement and all that kind of stuff. And that was quite difficult. You're thinking in two heads. So one head, I'm thinking, you know, in mum, M-U-M, and another head, I've got to put mom. Mm-hmm. So I've got, you know, it's tricky. And I'm currently just writing a book where the setting is actually in New York with some Kiwi characters and then a mix of Americans in the background. So I just write what I write, and then I let my editor kind of mop up the pieces afterwards. But I didn't deliberately? I suppose I did by choosing to do it that way. Just aim to put Kiwi stuff out there, really. Mm-hmm. Like I wasn't writing for a Kiwi audience, didn't write thinking only Australians and English people will buy, although I knew that might be my foundation. I want, you know, if you don't get into the States market, then you're not going to sell as many books. So I just kind of hoped after how well the first couple of books did, and they were written in, you know, our English, in New Zealand English, and I didn't make any changes to accommodate American readers, and they sold really well. And the comments were that was what was liked, was the fact that was so Kiwi. So I then just ditched any idea of trying to cater and just decide to write with a write, and if it's liked, it's liked, and it'll find its audience.
Yeah.
And it does change it, and it did certainly, it built, I got Australian audience and UK audience quite quickly. They were always really good to me, and it's taken much more promotion and much longer to break into the American readership.
But you have got them now, that they are reading the books. And
yeah, now I sell more. I sell, they are my largest chunk of the pie graph now to America.
Well,
there's awesome. So many of them.
Exactly.
I mean, exactly.
Because that's
something
you say
that
like it's a bad thing.
Yeah.
No, I'm saying you would be silly to exclude them.
Oh, yes. But also I think that it's like timing is everything again. There was a time probably 20, 30 years ago, maybe as early as 20 years ago, and when writing Kiwi in Kiwi land and Kiwi stories would have been a hard sell. Mm-hmm. That's not the case anymore. I mean, when I started putting my stuff out there, it was just kind of after the Christchurch terror attacks and stuff, and we had Jacinda Ardern and the Loved all over the world, and people were interested in what was happening down here, Peter Jackson, and all of that kind of stuff was happening. Mm-hmm. So it was like, you know, if they're not going to love us now, they're never going to love us. So
Exactly. That's a really awesome point, because you're right, like we have been told as New Zealanders, I don't write from New Zealand perspective, and don't you know, use American English and do all those kinds of things, and it's awesome to see someone kind of not doing any of those things and being successful. So that's really cool.
I think it's about if you get the story right, you can put the story anywhere.
Yes.
So I don't write necessarily a Kiwi story, I write a story that will be universal, and then I happen to set it in New Zealand. So and we're an interesting destination tourism wise. People, even if they haven't been here, have heard about us. We're on bucket lists, even if no one's ever gonna, you know, come
get in the country again.
It's like, well, why not use that? And I know this land more than I know anything else. So you know, it would be silly for me to waste that. I don't want to be confined here, which is why I dabble with characters outside, but it's comfortable for me and it's working, so
that's the most important thing.
Exactly. It ain't broke. So let's talk about pricing is my next thing on my list. So your books, I think we saw that were priced at $5.99, is that right? Yeah. So is that just that's what you did? There was no sort of thought of making them lower, or
I started off at $4.99. Mm-hmm. There's a part of that is because my books are long, so you are getting twice the book of a 60,000, you know, nearly 60,000 new book. So you're getting quite a lot of book for your money, and so therefore there's a lot of other things, you know, involved in time and everything that goes into that. And so I kept it at $4.99 for a while. Unguarded, which was part of Serena Bowen's world, Beno and Veritas world, that's selling for $3.99. In a shared world, that's kind of fairly common.
Mm-hmm.
And I did have mine at $4.99 until probably put all my books up about middle of last year. Mm-hmm. And I just put them up across the board in one go.
Okay. Yeah, that's awesome. And have you seen any kind of a change?
I'm selling more. Oh,
wow.
Yes, that's what you want.
Yeah. Well, I'm certainly selling more ebooks. And as I say, the KU reads, you know, the longer books anyway. Mm-hmm. But I think it's just at some point you recognize the amount of hours that you've put into it. I wouldn't want to put it longer than that. Higher than that. Mm-hmm. There are books out there, you know, at $6.99, $7.99. And when I was with like Dreamspin and the publishers, some of my books were up nearly $8, you know, and I was looking at those thinking, I'm a new author, this is ridiculous. You know, I shouldn't be at this price, but because they want their cut out of it.
Yes.
So the pricing goes up, which is disadvantageous to new authors. So when I got all my stuff back, I worked I employed a PA to help me because I had absolutely no idea what I was doing. And we talked about the pricing then and settled on kind of $4.99 based on the length of the book and the fact that I wasn't brand new, but I was new but getting a bit of traction. And then we left it at that until kind of things solidified a bit more. And then middle of last year, or towards the end of last year, we put them up again, but it will sit like that. We won't be doing that for a while, and at the same time we'll shuffle other prices, like First Impressions is kind of will become, if not a 99 cent, it could even become a free entry into that series. So now that I've got a few more books on the table, I can be a bit more creative and flexible with how I price entries into series and things like that.
Yeah, and you've also started doing translations. How's that going?
Well, when I was with Dream Spinner, Juno took a contract on the Auckland Med series. So I left that, they were actually good enough. They hadn't produced the translation by the time I left Dream Spinner. They're actually good enough to negotiate with Dream Spinner so that Dreamspinner let that go, and they picked up the contract directly with me, which is good. So they do that series. I have very little to do with it. They just tell me when it's going up. It's a bit of a slower process. I think they're only done the second one last year.
Can I just clarify the name? Sorry, was it Juno? Did you
Juno, say? Yeah.
J-U-N-O, as in.
Yeah. They do the French. And German, MM is very, very popular in Germany, but translators, because of that, are hard to come by.
Yes.
So I'm actually getting my first German ones translated this year in June, July. We'll see how that goes. So I have to make sure the translations are done. That's a private thing. I'm doing that privately. I don't like giving up my rights now. Learned some lessons. And so when I couldn't get the German ones, I did Italian last year and also did them privately. So I just found Driscoll, who are a publishing house, but also do private translations. So they do all my translations. I have an Italian reader who goes through them and proofs them. And she's good because she knows my books.
Yep.
So she'll say, actually, colloquially, this is a better phrase to use than this. Mm-hmm. So I might make some odd adjustments. But yeah, so I handle those and pay for the translations myself.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. With the audio, do you have a Kiwi
narrator? No, I don't. There might be some around now. It's actually quite difficult to find Kiwi narrators who are narrating fiction. There's a lot of Kiwi narrators who are doing voiceovers or are narrating non-fiction books, but to find one who's doing fiction, let alone romance, let alone gay romance, and who's comfortable in all those spaces, and who also fits the characters, it was really hard. I did audition quite a few people, and one guy I really liked, he in the end decided that wasn't for him.
Right.
Because he had never done romance, and he just in the end decided he didn't want to go that way. So I got a help from a lady who has they have a pod and a blog called Audio Gals. And she does reviews audios all the time. So I contacted her and just said to her, could you give me what I wanted and could you give me some names that could be useful? Because I didn't really know. I never listened to an audio book. I really didn't like them until I started putting out my own. Now I love them and listen to them all the time. And so she gave me a few names of ones that she really liked, and that eliminated a bit in between because I also wanted to pay for it myself again. I didn't want to go through. I had to head offers to contract all of my series. And by through Tantal, and decided that I didn't want to do, I was going to have a look myself first. So I found Gary Furlong, who's actually Irish, living in the States, and is it Florida? I can't remember. And he has a really good, we aimed for a neutral accent.
Yeah.
So he can do it. Enough of a Kiwi slang that you believe it, and most everybody else believes it. But he gets a few things wrong along the way, but not that any people would pick up. But he has a really good neutral voice, and he's got great accents, American accents, and he's got other he can do all sorts of different characters. Really important that he could do my theme characters like Cam and stuff like that. So because they huge reader favorites. So yeah, we work together and I pay him directly, and then I upload it to use Findaway. And
How long have you been doing them, and is it kind of, have you seen a return on them? Are they
they're very expensive to do, and because you pay per finished hour, how long,
and your books are long.
The big disadvantage,
only time limits.
but that was the other reason to go with somebody outside, someone who is known and who's known in MM. Gary was kind of newish to MM, but not new, and he was starting to build quite a big following. So people love him. And he's crazy as a bag of snakes. He's got an Instagram thing. He's a complete loon. He swears like a trooper. I love him. And he does live reads and stuff on his Facebook page. But because you've got a following, you'll get readers, listeners, who will buy everything he does, regardless of what it is. And that's quite important with marketing and promotion, is to, you're buying into an already existing readership. And someone who's known within the MM community and who's already got some reviews and stuff out there, rather than trying to break through with somebody brand new. So, and that helps get your return back, because, you know, each one of my audiobooks is close to 3,000 to get done in audio, and so that takes a long time to earn that money back. But audio for me is long-term thinking. Once they're done, they're there forever. They're in libraries and all over the place. And you might not see cash back on them, you know, above your debt for a while, but when they do, they're just sitting there and
when you own all the rights and you've got them all under your in your hands. So
And I do very little. He takes my script. He has his own proofers and his own people he uses. He loads it up on Findaway for me. So he just tells me it's there, ready to go whenever you're ready. So,
That's really good.
That's awesome.
I don't even listen to them now till they've already been published. That's kind of how much trust I have in what he's done.
Really? You don't read them?
I don't proof them at all. I don't,
Wow. That's awesome. Can I ask this? I know this is a silly question, but I just want to make sure. Is it always males who are reading? Like, is it always guys who are reading the MM romance, or is it ever females?
Narrators, you mean?
Narrators, yeah. Sorry. Yeah.
I can't imagine a female reading them.
No. I was just thinking.
I'm not sure the readership would go for that.
No.
Okay.
I agree. It just seems to,
Yeah, that's fine. I just was sort of thinking how would that work.
Sometimes that men don't do, men narrators don't quite get the female character voices quite right sometimes. Sometimes, you know, we're in our 50s, or they're doing a voice supposed to be a female in their 50s, and they all sound like they're 70-year-old women.
Yeah.
Broken voices and stuff. Yeah. And I'm like, you know, excuse me.
Yeah.
But it's more important that they get the male voices right. So, particularly when you've got, characters who are slightly off the beaten path.
Yeah, that's good. That's perfect. Sounds like you got the right kind of guy. He's fun. Yeah, that's what you want, right?
Yeah.
Okay. And what else do we need to ask about? I think we're coming into a close of what everything that we talked about, but that we were going to talk about. But is there anything else, any advice you want to give anyone, or anything you can think of that someone who's either thinking of getting into writing or specifically with MM romance that you could kind of advise them, or I don't know, any pieces of gold that you want to give them?
Probably nothing new. I think it's like anything, just research just means read all the books, you know.
Yeah.
And then before you write, I'm going to have this sort of dry. Before you write your characters, make sure you're getting it right, you know, for the community, for what you're trying to say. Use what, particularly for your first few books, write in an area you're comfortable with. You know, don't try and push yourself too far out there. So use maybe the context that you're in. If you're in New Zealand, write in a New Zealand book. There's actually quite a good audience for it, or there's a big audience for it now. Jax Colden's just done a rugby series, which is doing really well. So don't be talked into the fact that you need to change that, you know. So, and, you know, be prepared. That first book needs to be one, I think, personally, needs to be one that you think will kind of almost fit an expectation. You know, my first book was not the book that I wanted to write in my head. That was, came as the second and third book. The first book was kind of one, I just wanted to put a book out there to see whether I could get it right, you know, in terms of what the audience wanted. And mostly my writing style, you know, it's got almost like, put it out there, make sure that that there's something there that people actually want to read, look at the feedback, you know, try to, you know, to pay attention to the reviews that are helpful. And then, you know, save those big stories for when you've learned a little bit more. Sometimes a shame to put out the story you've always wanted to write when the audience isn't there to hear it.
Yeah, that's awesome. That's very wise Love words. That.
Very wise indeed.
Yeah. So if someone wants to find you, where would they go? Which is the best place to?
On my website, jayhoganauthor.com, there's all sorts of ways to connect with me there. There's all my social media stuff. I'm on Twitter and Instagram and, you know, heaven help me, I'm on TikTok. not me personally yet. I've just started, but there's some videos and things, which I've just started to do actually, video promos for my books. I'm you can find me in all this the social media things, but there is a in my Instagram, actually, if you go into my bio, there's a link there will take you to all of my stuff, everywhere you can find me.
Okay.
And the same on my website, there's a link in there that shows
everything.
Emails, everything. Yeah, newsletters.
That's awesome.
All of that.
So you've got, sorry, I just realized we didn't ask you whether you had a newsletter. So you've obviously got a newsletter and you use that and you're using all the socials. Do you think that's an important part of what you do as well? Like you're connecting
these with days, readers? It definitely is. Yeah, it's amazing to think I am more savvy at my social media than my 30-year-old daughter is. So
go, yo.
That's awesome. All right.
Yeah.
So if anyone wants to check out what Jay does on all those social medias, go to the website and click those links, I think is the best way to do it, and research it that way for now. But thank you so much for coming on the show. It's been a pleasure having you here. Really thank enjoyed you, chatting. And where can we be found, Shah?
We can be found at spargirlspodcast.com. And unlike Jay, we are not on TikTok yet, but the pressure is building. I can feel that in my bones. But we come along to our website and check us out on YouTube as well.
Awesome. Thank you, and thank you for joining us, and thank you to everyone listening to another episode of the Spa Girls podcast. We'll be back again next week, but for now, farewell.
Bye.
Bye.